Hey, welcome back to another video. Today we're going to be talking about shape layers. Shape layers are the backbone of motion graphics. So if you're to become the motion designer that you aspire to be, you got to have a good handle on shape layers and what you can do with them. Now, if you're new to After Effects, I suggest you go watch my intro to shape layers, where I go into how shape layers work and what they're made of. Link in the description. In this video though, we're gonna go a little bit deeper and I'm gonna share with you 7 tips and tricks you can use on shape layers. So without further ado, let's get started. All right, let's kick this video off with a really rather simple one, but it's not as straightforward as it may seem, and that is how to draw a triangle. So if you go up to the shape tools, you'll notice there's a tool for rectangle tool and an ellipse tool, a polygon tool, even a star tool, but there's no tool for a triangle. You could use the pen tool, of course, to draw out your triangle, but then you end up with a wonky triangle. The way to create a triangle is actually with the polygon tool or the star tool. So in this case, I'm just gonna use the polygon tool and I'm gonna draw out my polygon right here. And right now I have a polygon with 6 points. And before I release my mouse click, I'm going to do Alt down arrow until it reduces down to 3 points. Now I have a triangle. I want to make a note that if you use the Alt arrow key method, you are setting the default points for that tool, the polygon tool, to 3 points. So anytime you use that tool to draw another shape, you're going to be drawing another triangle. If you want to get back to drawing a polygon, you can do the same thing, but in the opposite direction. So Alt and the up arrow key. So I'll just draw my triangle, and before I release my mouse click, I'll do Alt up until I have the number of points I want. You can also go into the contents shape path and change the number of points in there if you don't want to mess around with the defaults. All right, so shape morphing in After Effects is actually pretty straightforward. You just need a keyframe for your beginning shape and a keyframe for your end shape. Now, I want to note that in order to morph between two shapes, you have to be using Bezier paths. And if you don't know the difference between a Bezier path and a parametric path, go check out my video on Intro to Shape Layers, link in the description, where I go over those two differences. Now, I've created a square here, and we're going to morph this square into a circle. Now, I know, this isn't the most exciting morph, but it's a great morph to show you the fundamentals of how this process works so that you know how to avoid common pitfalls when morphing between two shapes, because I guarantee the first time you do it, you're not going to get a result that you're pleased with. So by using this simple example, I can illustrate to you some of the common issues that happen when morphing, and you can avoid those and you can then move on to more complex shapes. So let's jump in. So the first thing is I'm gonna go to the path property here on the square and I'm gonna create a keyframe to mark that shape. Then I will go a couple of frames down and this is where we're gonna be pasting our second keyframe for the circle. But first we need to get that circle information. So to create that, I'm gonna use the ellipse tool and I'm gonna make sure that the Bezier path is selected, or this little thing is checked, so that I'm making a Bezier circle and not a parametric circle, which again, to emphasize, you cannot morph between a Bezier path and a parametric path. Okay, so now that we've got that all set up, I'm just gonna select my square here just so I can get this little anchor point marker so I know exactly where the center of my shape is. And then from there, I'll hold Control Shift and drag out till I fill my square. And now I have my circle path information that I can then go in and copy by hitting Control C, and then I will select the path of my rectangle and hit Control V, and that will paste it, and you can see my square turned into a circle. However, now this is where you probably fall into the same pitfall, but when we morph this, let me just turn off that ellipse. When we morph between these two, this is not the kind of morph that we wanted, and that is because the shape is flipping, because one keyframe, the path shape is going in one direction, and then the second keyframe, the path is being drawn in the second direction. So we need to flip one of these paths. We're gonna flip the circle. So I will select that keyframe and double click on one of the points, which will select all of my keyframes. And then I'm gonna turn back on the ellipse just to use as a guide again. And then we will select all those, and we holding Control, we'll just transform this and flip it like that. Now, if I turn off that ellipse, we can see that this shape transform is much more pleasing, but there's still something weird with it because it's kind of, it feels like it's rotating. And that is because if we look at the points, these points are all having to move to the corresponding position on the circle. To fix this, we just need to rotate the circle. And I know that the top point here is the first vertex. And if I go to the square, the first vertex is over here on the right corner. So I want those first vertex on both shapes to be in relatively the same position. So I'm going to select my shape path and rotate it to the right so that these points are just moving in like that. So there you go. That's how you morph a shape. Next, I want to talk to you about merge paths, which can be found in this little menu right here. Before I add the merge paths to my shape layer though, I need to combine my shapes into one group. So I'll select both of them and hit Control G. And now with group one selected, I will add my merge paths. Merge paths is like the Pathfinder in Illustrator, except instead of nice little icons that show you what each function does, you just have a little drop-down menu right here. Now by default, when you add a merge paths, it is set to add, which you can see right here. Now the only other mode I wanna call out in this segment is the subtract, because you need to know how it works in order to use it correctly. Subtract subtracts whatever shape is on the bottom of the stack from the shape that is first. And I can add as many shapes below this first shape as I want, and it will subtract all of these different shapes from that original shape. Now you can do some really cool things with merge paths in terms of drawing shapes in After Effects. Here I have this little fuselage of a rocket ship where I have this little shaded area, this tip. I'm using the merge paths to create these two segments, and I'm using merge paths on the fuselage. So let me break that down for you. If we open up the contents of this shape layer and I solo the fuselage, you can see the fuselage is made up of a rectangle and two ellipses at the top and bottom with a merge path set to add to make this shape. Now the point is made up of two groups, which is this group, which is just the triangle that makes up this base shape, and then the tip, which is using a merge path with two triangles offset from each other, and I'm using the intersect mode. And then to create the shadow of this, I'm actually duplicating the fuselage and the point, creating a new group from all those, duplicating that group, and then using a subtract merge paths, and then taking the second group, and I'm just offsetting it to create that shadow. And then I have the fill of this group set to black and the overlay mode set to soft light. And that's how I'm creating that shadow. Okay, so the next one is trim paths. Now, trim paths is a must know because it is probably the most common technique you'll be using as a motion designer. So to set this up, I have a rectangle with the fill turned off. Trim paths work best with the fill turned off because it's really primarily used to draw on and off strokes. So I have a box around my text here and I want to draw this box on. So I'm going to add a trim path by selecting the rectangle group here, going to the add menu and adding trim paths. Then in the trim paths, I have the start and an offset. To draw this on, I'm going to use the end and I'm going to create a keyframe and drag that keyframe out a couple frames. And then on the first frame, I'm going to change the end to 0 and you'll see that the stroke disappears. But if we preview this animation, we can see that it is now drawing on the rectangle. And then I'll just add some easing and boom. We have a nice little animation of it drawing on. And then also with the offset, we can actually change where the path starts and ends. So I'm gonna create a keyframe on the first frame with the offset. And then I'm gonna go to my second keyframe and create a keyframe. And I'm just gonna drag this to about 90 degrees. And then when we preview this, we'll see that it's a little bit more dynamic, a little less static. So that's it. You're going to be using trim paths all the time as a motion designer. In fact, we're going to be using trim paths in some of the upcoming tips, so stay tuned for that. Okay, on this next one, I'm going to show you a little trick with the round corners effector. Now this effector is great if you want those round corners when you're using a Bezier path. However, on this Bezier path, I don't like how it's rounding out this section of the chat bubble. I want that to be a little more structured, but because of the way that this effector works, it's kind of making this little weird, unpleasant to the eye blob. So to fix that, I'm gonna go up here to the Add Vertex tool, and I'm going to select my path, and I'll zoom in. And to make this corner sharper and this sharper, I'm just gonna add a vertex to these two points. And then I'm gonna just slide that point right on top of that other one. So there we go. Now I have that little part that juts out and my shape's got nice rounding on the rest of those corners. Okay, now let's talk about how we create these little impacts that are very common in motion design. To do this, we need to have the proportional grid turned on, which you can turn on right here so that we know where the center of our composition is. Okay, with the pen tool selected, I will draw my line starting from the center and going down. Next, I'm gonna change the cap of my stroke to be rounded, and I'm using this little tool right here called Mobar. If you're interested in learning more about this tool, you can go check out my last video where I talked about it, or you can go to the link in the description and check it out there. Okay, so I've got my line. Now I just need to add a repeater to it. By default, I have three copies, and we have a transform menu for the repeater. The first thing I'm gonna do is I'm going to zero out the position, and then I need to start working with the rotation. Now I can do 360, because that's one full rotation divided by how many points that I want. So let's say I want six lines coming off of this. I'll just do 360 divided by six, and then I'll just need to go up to the copies and add six, because that's how many times I divided 360 by. Six evenly spaced lines. Next, I just need to add a trim paths to the shape. And then just like before, I'm gonna bring the end down to zero, add a keyframe, go out a few frames and go to 100. And then I'm actually going to do the same with the start, and I'm going to offset the start keyframes a little bit. So here we have this. If I preview that, boom. Now that's a little slow, so I'm gonna speed it up and probably add some easing, and boom. We got a nice little impact, not too hard, right? Okay, to finish off, we're gonna show you how to do this little squiggly animation, which is pretty simple, and we're gonna be using two different effectors. We're gonna be using trim paths and the zigzag effector. So to start out, we're gonna start out with this straight line right here, and we are going to add a zigzag effector. And by default, it's set to corner. We're gonna change that to smooth and increase the size so we can see our waves. Now, the next thing we're gonna do is we are going to add a trim paths. And on that trim paths, we're gonna set the end to 50. Then we're going to animate the offset from 0 degrees and to 180 degrees. The next thing is we need to fix the ridges per segment. Now the ridges per segment has to be set to every other odd number starting with 3 in order to loop seamlessly. So I'm gonna set this to 7, and that way the beginning of our stroke and the end of the stroke are, you know, it's starting on the lowest part and ending on the lowest part of the wave. That's crucial for this to loop correctly. Now we just need to animate one last thing. We don't want this loop to be moving across the composition. We want it to be staying in the same position, which means we need to offset it by animating the position of this shape group. Now make a note here, I'm not gonna be keyframing the position of the shape layer, because we still wanna be able to move this squiggly animation around the composition. I'll be adding keyframes to the position of the shape group. Okay, but before I do that, I need to create some guides. So I'm gonna use Mobar here to create a guide on the left and on the right. If you don't have Mobar, you can create these guides by pulling up your rulers and creating them that way. But now that I have those guides in place, I can create a keyframe on the position. This is where it's gonna start. go to the second keyframe, and then I'm gonna bring it back to where it was using those guides. Now it stays in the same position. All I have to do now to loop this is add a loop out expression to these properties. So I will hit U to bring up the two keyframe properties. I'll select them both, and I'm gonna use my MoBar to add the key looper. I'm gonna add a loop out expression, set to cycle, create those loops. If you don't have MoBar to add the expression to your property, just alt click on the stopwatch, which will bring up this little section here. And then you can just start typing out loop, and you select loop out, and it's set to cycle by default, so you don't need to write anything in these little parentheses. Now, when I play this back, it will loop seamlessly because we set those number of segments to 7. All right, so that's how you do this little squiggly animation. And that does it for today's video. If you learned something new, hit that like button. It helps me in the algorithm. And if you want more content like this in the future, make sure you're subscribed and with that bell notification turned on so that you're notified anytime I post a new video. We also do live streams every week on Thursday evenings, so make sure you tune in on those. I cannot stress enough how important it is to know and be familiar with shape layers as a motion designer, because you're going to be using them all over the place. So if you have any questions about shape layers or anything I taught in today's video, leave those questions in the comment section below, and we'll see you guys in the next video.